So I change strings about once every 3 days. It's not that bad. It's every night on the road. Every other night, maybe, depends on the gig. If it's like a big gig, pop gig, then it's normally every night. If it's more of a jazz thing, maybe my own thing, it's every other night. It's also a space thing. How many boxes of these bad boys can I take with me? I use DR, high beams. Five string E to C on my main bass, 100 through 45, so it's 100, 85, 65, 45, and a 30 currently on the C string. Used to be a 32. Checking out a slightly lighter C string on the top. And there's just something that happens when I change strings. The inspiration that a fresh set gives me that is totally unique. And it's never gotten old. Let's face it, I've been changing my strings for 25 years, more than 26 years. And it's never gotten old. It's always been that moment of like, okay, what am I gonna find next that I hadn't heard before? That's basically what I'm looking for. And that's kind of what the string change gives me. I'm also changing the strings, not just because I want to feel that, you know, that moment of inspiration, but because they need it. I practice a lot. More than most people, maybe. Less than some, for sure. But I do practice a lot. Now, these strings are quite unique, actually, because they are about 5 days old, because I have been so busy doing other stuff besides practicing bass. We just put the new book out. There's a lot of stuff happening, but I haven't actually been playing as much as I normally do. And what is it, I hear you ask, what is normal practice time? I would say right now, especially as we find ourselves in the middle of this global pandemic, I would say right now we're looking at about 4 to 6 hours a day of practice. That's kind of average. But the last few days, not so much. And not only, like I said, do I get this kind of kick, this new inspiration of being able to hear all these extra harmonics. It's when the strings are at their most, I don't know, buoyant, their most full. It's when the strings, I think, can contribute the most to the musical situation, at least for me, at least for my ear, at least for my music. I know some people don't change their strings more than once a year, once every 2 years, once every 10 years. I have basses that have strings on them. Some of these down here, I haven't changed those strings in 15 years. So that definitely has its place. I am definitely a fan of that in the right moment. But what we are talking about here is unique to my daily routine, my everyday practicing. Hey, tone brush, very important. Give the pickups a quick work over. Pretty filthy in there. This is about my day to day and what it takes to get me going, and where I feel the most creative, the most productive, and where I feel like I can get to the end of the day having really accomplished something. A couple of things I like to use when I'm changing strings: this Jim Dunlop kind of neck brace stand thing, goes under the neck like that, keeps it up off the desk and kind of in a working situation. I use a Planet Waves string clipper, I guess for no other reason other than the fact that I have it. It's in the drawer down here with all the other crap. Works great. And I do take all the strings off the bass in one go, and I put them back on one by one from the center string out. High first, then low. It's just how I do it. It's habit. It's got nothing to do with what's right. I've had lots of comments in the past like, oh, you're supposed to change the strings one at a time. It will damage. No, it won't. It will not damage the neck of the bass. At least it hasn't damaged any of the necks on any of my basses, of which there are many and have been many over the past 25 years. So I'm gonna go ahead and say that is probably BS, and I wouldn't worry so much. And maybe unless you have a super cheap bass that's really moving around, I don't know, I haven't experienced that. Maybe that is a thing. But for the purpose of my routine and how I like to change the strings, I do it from the center out. And I've been in kind of a bit of a uninspired downward spiral the past days. Yes, I've been busy with other stuff, but when am I not busy with other stuff? I really haven't been that motivated to practice. And more sad for me, besides the practicing thing, is I haven't been motivated to write. And writing is like such a huge part of my process, and it's the thing that lasts, I think, longer than anything. You know, the compositions I write or we write will be around way longer than we ever will. So the playing is one thing, and feel comfortable with the instrument, be able to execute the sounds you're hearing by having enough technique to do that. But yeah, the music side of things, the writing thing, has not been happening the past few days. So I'm hoping that today, and hopefully captured in this video, I can put these strings on, find what I'm looking for, and get to something writing-wise. Very much looking forward to that. And nothing preconceived, I don't have any notes. I just thought, this is my process. Stick to this process, stick to what you know. When you're out of ideas, good idea to stick to what you know. And what I know is, change the strings, find some motivation, and get into the routine. Okay, so I've got the middle string in there, the D string. I go a little higher with the G string first, put the A string in there next. And at the same time, as much as I am sort of hoping to find something in the music and to find something compositionally and be inspired by the brand new kind of set of clearer harmonics I'm gonna hear out of these new strings and just the feel of it and the overall dynamic range that I'm gonna get out of a new set of strings, I am at the same time not going to force the issue. So if nothing comes, I'm not gonna be upset about it. I'm gonna be totally okay with the outcome no matter what. And I think that's really important. Whether it's about practice, about writing, whatever it is, whatever your goals are, I think it's really important to be okay with the outcome no matter what. Because we generally don't have that much control over it. We can prepare well. We can practice a lot. We can use repetition. We can use immersion. Those are the two big things I use in my technique, in my daily routine. And I'll show you, strings are going on. Three, that'd be awesome, huh? Three-string bass, pretty cool. Neck is a little wide for a three-string, but anyway, that's what it looks like so far. So yes, we can prepare as much as possible and be open-minded and be relaxed and all of those things, but we must be okay with the result, no matter what, good or bad. And it's rarely really that bad. If you consider something bad, perhaps that's something that you're not gonna use on a recording, maybe that compositionally, something you might consider bad is something that doesn't make it on an album. That doesn't mean to say there's not some value in it. No matter how remedial or how advanced an idea is for me, a compositional idea, a melody, a chord sequence, I'm always still a fan of cataloging that, writing it down somewhere in the scrolls, and maybe coming back to it later. Final string here. By the way, I like to clip the string, a little bit of slack past the machine head, clip it into the bridge, and then once I give it a couple of wounds, a couple of turns, shall we say, by hand around the machine head, of course I choose the E string, the thickest and most difficult string to put on the bass to explain this. Disaster. And then I do this. I'm not sure if it's good for the string or not. These strings can take anything, so I don't think it's bad for the string at all. I just keep some tension on it and wind it in by hand. I've seen people, they have like electric drill operated. Oh man, some fancy stuff. There is even this thing. I've never used it. Hey, you know what? I'm going to use it for the very first time right now. I'm right-handed. This is not good. Okay, that's so silly, I can't even use it. I'm so much quicker with my hands. Trying to figure out how many times I've actually done this in my life. The number has to be pretty high. It's like a tennis player. How many tennis balls has a tennis player hit over their lifetime? Millions, probably. How many laps has a racing car driver done around a circuit in their career? Like those kind of stats. I'm sure this one is pretty high. All right, let's get this thing in tune. Probably some volume would help that. Yes, 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 yes. Using the HX stomp down here on the floor to tune up. I like to get it roughly there, slightly flat, maybe not the line totally in the middle, get it slightly flat so I'm not at full tension. And then once I'm there, like all the strings are slightly flat right now, then I will lean into them a little bit on the bridge here. Let's see if I can show you that. And just press down, give them a little bit more of a stretch right around the bridge. I'm not sure if these are pre-stretched or not. I don't know. This is just pure habit now. This entire process is pure habit, having done it so many times. Maybe you guys want to guess how many times I've changed my strings. If I started playing bass when I was 15, that is 20, that's 25, almost 26 years ago. Maybe you guys want to have a guess about how many times I've changed my strings. comments below. That would be interesting to see where you guys think that number might be. And then after I push down in the bridge a little bit, I kind of like to pull them up a little bit around the end of the fingerboard. And also make sure they're seated in the bridge. The amount of times I've had something riding up here and I think, okay, everything's good, I'm in tune, and I go to play and then bing! And it drops down into the saddle properly where I should have seated it first. And then I'm super flat on one string. So I like to give them a little bit of a stretch there. I don't have a nut anymore. I have, it's just a string guide here because I have a zero fret on this bass. So I used to do that thing as well because sometimes the grooves, I had a metal nut on one of my older Federas and the grooves in the strings would get caught on the nut and I'd just like to make sure it was seated properly. Again, this is just my habit that I've built over so many years. I'm not a guitar tech, bass tech, anything like that. Luthier, nothing like that. It's just my little process for doing it. And it's working pretty good so far, I gotta say. Not so bad. All right, let's get this thing really in tune now. And then we can plug it in and make some sounds. All right, let's grab a strap. Oh, you are hearing literally the first notes of a new set of strings. Not the, oh, I did 5 minutes before I, you know, before I started shooting the video, but the literal first few notes. Oh, I feel so, the feel, that's the thing as well. That's the huge part of it is the feel with the right hand. Let me make sure I am not completely crushing your ears here with the input. Very nice. And also the tension is there again, maximum tension. I'm guessing, I don't know for sure, but I'm guessing the string tension changes slightly. I know I feel it change slightly over the, if I leave the strings on too long. They do get a little soft after a while. And just the, you know, all the things that go into a set of strings getting dead and grease and sweat and salt and all, just general dirt in the strings. Oh, but that is a good feeling. Now I have to figure out where I'm at in terms of my sound. Make sure nothing has changed in the signal chain. And I think this is maybe the most important aspect of the new set of strings for me. When I play that chord there, it's just F, triad in first inversion, F over A. The amount of detail I can hear in it when the string is brand new, it's a symphony orchestra of harmonics, of a symphony orchestra of potential compared to a slightly deader string, where I'm not getting like the maximum range out of it. So some people call me crazy for changing my strings so much. I think maybe you might want to think just for a second about experiencing that. Or just maybe you haven't paid attention to that when you've changed your strings before and you've gone like straight in and done whatever you were doing right before. Maybe just take a second and sit back. Figure out exactly what has just been added to your range. Ooh. I do need some setup action on this. Slight change there. I just switched the kinky boost in the HX Stomp out for the EP booster, the exotic EP booster. Okay. Thank you. How about I was trying to force something there. That is fatal. I always will kick myself in the ass when I try and force something and realize, thankfully, quite quickly that, okay, stop trying to get back to something you thought was hip a day ago, a year ago, 10 years ago. Just keep going and moving forward. Look for the new thing. That is probably what's going to be the most rewarding. Ooh, the detail. I got to get a little more volume in the room. At least I'm feeling loose, feeling somewhat inspired. Who knows where it's gonna go, but the one thing I'm noticing right now after I've played a little is that it's not a no. It's not, okay, it's not working, so I'm gonna put the bass down. It's definitely a, wow, now I'm curious. And now it's time to get in here and do some work and actually just warm up my basic technique a little bit, because it's been a few days since I really, you know. Since I really got in there and did some stuff like this. And worked both octaves where I can. Come on. Even here, maybe? Maybe not so practical. Uh, There it works. Ah, come on. And maybe my instincts are not firing as quickly as perhaps they could or have done in the past. So that's something, that's a motivating factor to get in and do some work today. Really make like the practice room, really make it work for me and enjoy the process. I guess I'm gonna leave you with that sentiment, with that thought. And it's the most important one for me. It's the biggest key. And it is the thing that has got me to where I am. It's any minute success or amount of progress I've ever had with my playing, with my music, with my career, with my life, it always boils down to the same thing. It's that I love the work. There's no escaping the work if you have goals that are kind of far away and a little tough to reach. It's a lot of work. Really easy once you figure out what that is, because the path is very defined and okay, you're lacking in this place, so that's the place I need to go work on my playing. So in that sense, the process can be quite simple, but it's not easy. Simple, but not easy. It is simple, but incredibly hard because of the length of the road. Not that the road is defined and is well surfaced and well lit and well signposted. That is very much in effect. That is how it is. It is very well signposted, especially with all the information we have around us, all the books I produce, for instance, the videos, Janek's Bass Studio, the new Pentatonic book, just the sheer quantity of material from any musician for any instrument that's sitting on YouTube for free right now. That road is quite defined. Yes, you have to sift through a few things, through some nonsense, through some BS, through some people just trying to take your money rather than actually give you useful information. But those are like a little wrong turn that you always kind of make your way back to the main road from. So again, not a massive problem. The biggest obstacle to overcome is the actual work, putting in the hours, spending time with the instrument and reaching that full immersion state and repetition state in order to make this as natural as you speak your native language. So I'll leave you with that. I'm in love with the work. I always have been since day one. I hope you find a way to be in love with the work if you're not already. Perhaps you are and you're sitting there going, yep, that's me. Yep, I've been down that road, took that wrong turn, took the detour, made it back again, saw some crappy YouTube videos, found some really good stuff. Maybe that's you. But if it isn't, I would highly recommend finding a way to love the work. And one of those simple things, one of those kickstarters to get me moving and to get me into the process can be as simple as just changing my strings. I'm lucky that I get to do it often and I get that sort of reboot maybe a little more often than some people, but whenever you do it, however you do it, maybe pay a little more attention to that process and what you can get out of it, what new sounds you can find in your instrument that perhaps you hadn't heard before. So that's it. Thank you very much for spending some of your incredibly precious time with me. Please do not underestimate the power you have just by hitting the thumbs up and subscribing to the channel or leaving a comment below this video. That is huge in terms of growing the channel and allowing me to continue to make free content like this for you guys. So thank you, and I will see you all on the next video.